Other people my age are sort of retiring, and we're sort of in the middle of the excitement in the world, and it's an enormous opportunity.
Well, 7 or 8 years before I left, I said, I don't want a raise, I want more time off. Johnny Carson and I had a race to see who could get the most time off.
Honestly, I understand that people who've seen me on television might now not think of me as regular, but I still do, and I always will.
I knew that a great deal of attention was paid to Governor by the media. It is so much more extensive than anything I had expected. You know it academically, but the real thing is quite different.
There are interviews, and then there are Barbara Walters interviews. What are your feelings about what makes yours so different and so special?
Join us now as we reverse the roles with one of television's highest acclaimed journalists. Tonight, the Barbara Walters story, The Opposite Side, with Patsy Smolin.
Barbara, could you share with us a little bit about your childhood and its impact on you today?
That's always a question that I ask in the specials. And I start out asking about childhood because I think it's always so revealing. My father was in show business. He was what we would call an impresario. He was a great showman. He did the shows. He was not a very good businessman. And he had nightclubs called the Latin Quarter, which at the time were very famous. The first one was in Boston, where I was born. Then there was one that opened in Florida, and finally in New York. So we traveled from Boston to Florida to New York, and my childhood was somewhat broken up by different schools and different cities, and I guess I didn't love it too much. I had an older sister who many people in later years thought was my younger sister, who was mildly retarded. At the time, very little was known about retardation. Children can be very cruel, and they were cruel to her and cruel to me. And I think that probably my sister and her life had the most effect on me. My sister died a few years ago from cancer. I wouldn't be talking about her today. But I was very close to my family, but it certainly wasn't an easy, happy family. I wasn't surrounded by relatives because we kept moving. There was always the problem of my sister and the sadness of her. And a father who was essentially a gambler at heart, and eventually almost a gambler in real life. And when I was in my early 20s, he lost everything. And for almost the rest of my life, I supported my family. That's important because I think with many men of my generation, if the job for a man was difficult, unpleasant, routine, he had to stick with it. My friends, if any of them worked and it was any of those things, left. I couldn't leave. And ultimately, I think that was very good. Too long an answer?
No, not at all.
I'm just trying to think as I talk to you, where would I have cut?
In 1976, you became the highest paid journalist in television history.
Not true. It never came out correctly, but it really wasn't. Although I don't know why I dispute it, because it was supposedly a very big deal. When I came here to ABC for that famed $1 million salary, and it was said that I was the highest paid person in news, I wasn't. I received exactly the same amount of money that Harry Reasoner was getting, which was $500,000, which was lower than a lot of newsmen were getting then. And certainly there weren't too many newswomen. And the other was to do 4 1-hour prime time specials a year. They were getting a bargain. Nobody cared about those specials. The press didn't care about the specials, and they were specials I wanted to do. And the money was not for news. Those specials are today under the news department. Then they were in the entertainment department. But the press just thought that this was so horrendous, although at that time every person in news came in and asked for a raise, and it then became the kind of contract that everyone looked at. I don't know why I'm still defending myself. I guess it was such a terrible year, and I received so much criticism, and in part because of that, that here it is 15 years later that I'm still saying, wait a second, please understand.
Well, I'm glad you did.
Well, I mean, I can hardly cry about it. It was a wonderful salary, whatever it was. But it wasn't the greedy lady, who does she think she is, coming in and hurting all of these great newsmen by demanding this enormous salary and so on, which was the way it was, I think, presented at the time.
Nevertheless, you've been called the most influential woman in television history. Did you ever dream this would all come about?
I never dreamed that I would be on the air. I mean, I had started out when I graduated from college, and I say this to young people all the time, I didn't know what I wanted to do. I thought I'd want to teach. I liked children. I was going to go into graduate school. And little by little, I got into television and was a writer. I was for television shows. I was behind the scenes. I never raised my hand and said, hey, what about me? Because all the women at that time were very glamorous. I certainly wasn't. So that what has happened to me, I consider myself enormously lucky. I am in the middle of contract negotiations. By the time this is on, I will have finished them, so I can say this now. I would do this for nothing. And how wonderful to be able to say that. The people that I've met, the life that I've had, a lot of it was good luck, a lot of it was hard work, but I mean, so much of it was just being there at the right time.
Your climb in this male-dominated industry, what are your reflections on that now, today in this world as opposed to 20 years ago?
It's terribly different, terribly different. Although I don't think we sat in those days and said, why aren't I entitled to this, or why aren't I doing that? I do remember that in my early days on the Today Show, the only way I could do a so-called hard news interview myself is if I got it out of the studio. I did Henry Kissinger in those early days, Dean Rusk. Because if I got the interview and I did it out of the studio, I, the woman, could do it. If it were in the studio, the host would automatically do it, the man. And I was not a co-host almost until my last years on the Today Show. Today, all the women on the morning shows are automatically co-host. And there was a time with one of the hosts, not Hugh, not my wonderful good friend Hugh Downs, when I wasn't allowed to come into until the fourth question. The fourth question, if it were a Washington interview, I could ask a question. But I was lucky, I thought, to be able to do that. When I see the number of women today and the fact that women can do anything, I am enormously proud of them. And I know most of them, and they are awfully good and hardworking and smart women. But I didn't feel that I was blazing any trails. I found it frustrating. I didn't mind doing fashion shows. I liked that well enough. The biggest breakthrough for me was when I was a writer on the Today Show, and the producer said, she doesn't just have to write women's features. She can write anything the men can write. Doesn't that sound ridiculous? That the women only wrote women's features and the men wrote men's features? Anyway, it's better this way, isn't it?
There are interviews, and then there are Barbara Walters interviews. What are your feelings about what makes yours so different and so special?
I'm not sure, Patsy. I think I've sometimes said to people, don't listen to the first question. I mean, forget the first question, listen to the answer. I think you really have to be curious. I do a lot of homework. Some people don't. There are some who would rather just do it spontaneously. They don't want to read the books. They don't. I'm uncomfortable if I don't. But I try to think, what do most people want to know? And I ask those questions, even if they will, you know, make me not look so bright. I'm not aiming to make, page 12 of the New York Times. I want to ask what you want to know. I find I'm mellower. I am more compassionate. I think I can open people out without hurting. And I don't want to do an interview that hurts. Maybe that's age. Maybe, again, it has to do with my sister and my own life. Maybe it's just feeling more comfortable.
I'd like to list just a few of the people you've interviewed, and if you could share with us what comes to mind.
Okay.
Castro.
The fact that Fidel Castro has occupied so much attention in the world, and the small island, I guess, gives some picture of the charisma of the man. I don't think I've spent as much time, with the exception of Anwar Sadat, over a period of years, as I did in a small period of time with Castro. We spent about 10 days with him constantly going through the mountains where he had been a guerrilla fighter, crossing the Bay of Pigs with him. We were the first Americans to cross the Bay of Pigs since that time, since the invasion. He was funny, tough, talkative. Our interview was about 7 hours long. He blew smoke in my face for 7 hours. He stopped smoking those cigars. Argumentative, and one of the most interesting and forceful personalities I've ever met. Our crew felt the same way.
And Anwar Sadat.
Well, when people ask me, you know, it's very hard to always think of, or to ever think of what's the best and what's the worst, or who's, of everyone I've known, I think he is the man I most admired, because he had tremendous courage, certainly in what he did by going to Israel at that time, and also in his private life. I mean, he was a traitor to all the other Arabs when he went to Israel. I knew him fairly well. I probably did more interviews with him than any other reporter had.
George Bush.
George Bush is the only president whom I really knew before he was president, and liked him enormously. When he was ambassador to China and when he was here at the United Nations, we would occasionally have dinner together. As a person, he hasn't changed, and neither has Barbara Bush, and I think people realize this. There's the same warmth. He hasn't become a different person now that he's president. Although I think I'm treated the same way as any reporter, I don't get any more interviews because I've known him all these years. I perhaps have a special feeling about him because I really did know him before.
Barbara, how do you measure your success after an interview? How do you grade yourself?
If I'm doing a celebrity interview where they have been done and done, especially today when there are so many programs that do interviews, there is that moment when if you're fortunate, it sort of goes ping, you know you've gotten through, you've gotten something that somebody else hasn't gotten. And I can feel that. I know it when it happens. It doesn't always happen. I'm a tremendous second guesser. I finish an interview and then for days I'll say, why didn't I ask, why didn't I do, why didn't. Sometimes it's only when I've seen it that I know that it works.
Is there one you're most proud of?
No, I think, if you ask me about the experience, I would think it would be the whole experience in the Middle East before the signing of the Camp David Treaty, the knowing Menachem Begin and Anwar Sadat so well, the being able to play a small role in that, or certainly to be, as I said, involved in it, although, believe me, reporters didn't make any of it happen. So I think that was a very special time, but I can't think of an interview. I've done so many now. I'm sometimes amazed when I see how many I've done. It either makes me feel terrific or I think, oh dear, I should stop. I mean, I used to say that if Greta Garbo ever did an interview with me, that I would retire. And then I thought she would call up and say, you promise? You know, so some days I feel like that.
Have you ever been involved in an interview of national or international significance with world leaders where you actually felt, I might be able to say something that would alter the outcome of what's going on here?
I think in the Middle East I felt that the most, because when I would interview a Sadat and then even before Begin, Yitzhak Rabin, who was Prime Minister of Israel at the time, even before that, Golda Meir, and then I would go in a circuitous route to Lebanon to interview Yasser Arafat, and none of these people were talking to each other. I thought, I have the ability to ask a question here, to tell this one what this one said, to come back. It was a lot of power. And it seemed to me so so futile that these people could not talk. And in a sense, you were a messenger. You could move the story along. I can't think I can. I think I can have people perhaps understand a world leader better. But I certainly don't think that I ever can, you know, have affected the course of history.
How much do you see yourself as a news person, and how much do you see yourself as a star?
I only see myself as a news person. If I were going to do it for stardom or for money, I would have left news and gone into syndication. I mean, the people in syndication make more money in 1 year than we make in our lifetime. So if you're doing it for that, you don't stay in the news business. If you want to be treated like a star, you go under the entertainment banner, and you have press agents, and you have wardrobe people, and you... I have always worked in news. I know that I can cross the line. I mean, I know that not everybody can. I can. But I love news, and I like doing the specials, but if you said to me, well, I could do, for example, 6 specials a year, okay? Make a ton of money and not have to work as hard and travel all over the place as I do for 2020. In my new contract, I want to cut down on the number of specials. They want me to do more, I want to do less. I would never think of cutting down on 2020. And I also ask them to be able to substitute for Ted Koppel on Nightline, not that I particularly liked staying up that late, but because it's exciting to me to have one more avenue to talk to the news people, to be involved, and Ted, who was the best, and Ted and I are close friends, and, you know, I'm pleased that I'm able to do that. My heart is in news, my head is in news, and those of us who are in this simply have a different picture of ourselves. And in the news department, you're not catered to. When I first met my husband, he was very worried that I was an actress. Not that actresses aren't fine, but I said, don't worry, you know, we're a news, and you're just treated differently. And I think it keeps you sane.
What do you feel are the biggest misconceptions about you as a journalist and a person?
Maybe less now than there were, that I was a prima donna. I think the stuff from all of that days, I mean, you're in my office now. I used to read that I had a pink typewriter, that I had an enormous office, that I had limousines. I mean, all of the stuff that was very hard to refute. And so I think for years there was that, you know, the prima donna lady. I think before that, because I had to go out and get my interviews, it was, isn't she tough? I'm very authoritative on the air. In private life, I can't decide whether to wear the white jacket or the pink jacket, or should I have, a lot of indecision. And, but you have a presence on camera. But I also think that over the years, although I don't do a lot of interviews, that by now people do know me. I don't talk a lot about my personal life, but enough is now. I talk somewhat, I mean, it's not that I have anything against it, but I think enough is now known about me.
Who have been the most influential people to you in your career and in your personal life?
Influential in my career? Very few. I have huge respect for Rue Knowledge, who I think has made this a superb news department. There were no mentors when I was starting. I mean, there wasn't anybody I could go to for advice or look up to. So. I really can't answer that. Most influential in my personal life would have been, you know, the parents who bring you up, my sister whom I've talked about, and having a child. I would be a very different person if I didn't have a child. And I think there are women in news, again, maybe not the younger generation, and certainly on the morning shows you can have a child and, you know, be pregnant and go in the air and bring the baby in afterwards and so on. My day, I couldn't do that. And there are a lot of women who have not been able to consider having children because the life is so demanding. But certainly my daughter has had more influence in my life, on my adult life, than anyone else could have or ever will have. She still has the most influence in my life. Her happiness, her well-being, my love for her.
Do you like being a parent?
I love it. I wish I had more. Some days when she was going through adolescence, I wish I had none. But she's over that now, so we can laugh about it. She does too. I mean, she says, how did you stand me? I didn't know whether to kill her or kill myself. And I say this out there to parents of adolescents, when you think it will never end, it does. It takes time, but it does.
What have been the darkest times and the greatest times?
The darkest times were some of the times with some of the sadness with my sister. Because her life was so empty, and it might have been different today when we know so much more and we're so much more understanding. It was very hard for my parents, who loved her so and never left her and had no life outside of their life with her. I felt great guilt. Why her? Why not me? Professionally, the toughest time was when I left NBC and came to ABC that first year, which should have been wonderful. Where I was a failure, where I was working with a partner who was a nice man, Harry Reasoner, but sure didn't want me there. When I knew that I felt I was drowning and there was nobody who was saving me and I had the responsibilities of the family and I didn't know what kind of a career I would ever have, and here's where I'm grateful to Roon for knowledge, for being there and helping to guide. He wasn't in charge of news when I came here. That was professionally. It was a very difficult year, and it's made me cling to safety ever since. And some of the adolescent years with Jackie, when I was very worried about her, and afraid that because I had traveled and not been home so much, that perhaps I hadn't given her everything that I should have or could have. She's such a terrific girl that I have no worries about her now. And I also realized that children are their own people. They really are. So those were the worst times, but this is probably the best time. I wish I had felt this good, you know, 10 years ago or 20 years ago when I was, you know, younger. But it is a good, happy time of my life professionally, personally. I mean, a lot of things have worked out. It should just stay like, this is a glass desk, this is my desk, this table, and I'm knocking glass, but I guess it works as well as wood.
What do you want to do that you've never done?
I don't want to climb another mountain. If I had wanted to climb another mountain, there were mountains for me to climb now, where I would have had perhaps even my own show instead of having a partner. I prefer having the partner. Where there were great opportunities for new challenges and more fame and so on. And I thought, that's not what I want. I really want to enjoy my life a little more and have work that's interesting and nourishing, but not climb that next mountain. So I'd like it, if it could, just to stay a little peaceful for a while.
Do you feel like you have it all?
Nobody has it all. Nobody has it all. I talk more about my personal life now than I used to because I want people to realize that none of us have it all. Life works, or God works, or whatever happens in very strange ways. None of us have it all. And if we don't have a lot of troubles, we create them, you know? And I think it's important for people to know. I was once in a panel with John Chancellor and the late Teddy White years ago. We're talking about Jimmy Carter. And he had just become president, and we were saying he's this and he's that, and so on. And I finally said to the audience, look, ladies and gentlemen, be aware that there isn't one of us in this panel who a year ago would have told you that Jimmy Carter would be president. Please remember, we are not gods. And John Chancellor said, speak for yourself, Barbara. And we all laughed. But if there's anything that I can say in this interview is, you know, like us, trust us, listen to us. We do our homework. We do try to be knowledgeable. We are not gods.
Last question. I promised some viewers at home.
Okay.
If you were a tree, what tree would you be?
I will kill you. I asked Katharine Hepburn that question once, and because she had said to me, I'm like an old tree. And I said, what kind of a tree? And she said, I am like a great white oak. And everybody, I mean, for years asked me that question, and I thought, this is the question I hate most. I have done 120 interviews, and I asked it once. It's not so much that I'd like to be a tree as I'd like to be like Katharine Hepburn.
Thank you, Barbara.
Thank you.